Hi everyone, this is Nishan and Jyoti. Welcome to this course called as Economy Booster Sessions in just 10 minutes. So today the most important trending economy topic that I have chosen to discuss is Basel III norms. It is indeed one of the most important hit list topics based on economy, UPSC prelims and mains examination. So now to know regarding more about my courses, in the description box of this particular video, my Unacademy profile link is given. You can click to follow me for all the updates of my free class and plus class. And you can use the code NishaIASLIFE to watch the free class and also to get a discount of extra 10%. Okay, from the plus amount. So now in today's class, let's quickly have a look within less than 10 minutes regarding what is Basel norm. So now, the so-called Basel norm, it talks about the banking perspective. Norms are nothing but the rules or regulations or something as such. So you can call it as a Basel norm or a Basel accord. So mostly in many textbooks, you can find this term as such. So what are Basel norm? Before that, you should know what is Basel. See, actually, Basel is a city in Switzerland. Okay. And they have the headquarters, which is also the headquarters of the BIS. What is that? Bureau of International Settlement. So basically, this BIS, what do they do is they want to foster and do activities ensuring that there is a proper cooperation among the central banks of every country. The central bank of our country, India, is RBI. If you see the central bank of US, it is Federal Reserve Bank. So now the entire central bank of the globe, they have to function with a lot of cooperation and coordination to ensure that they are able to achieve the common objective or goal of attaining a proper financial stability in the market with regard to the banking perspective, right? So now this Basel norms, or let's say this Basel committee, consists of the central banks of almost all the economies, I can tell you, in the globe. And currently, how many member nations are there in the Basel norms or committee? You have 27 member nations. Now, Basel is basically a set of guidelines or rules, or let's say the norms, based on which the so-called banking perspective of every country has to function. So Basel guidelines refer to, let's say, some supervisory standards which are formulated by the so-called group of central banks called as Basel Committee on Banking Supervision, your BCBS. So what do they do is that they'll have a set of agreements or principles focusing on the risk of banks and the financial system, and that is called as Basel Accord. Okay. So to ensure a financial stability and to make sure that every single banking activity has been carried with a lot of efficiency and transparency, such kind of Basel norms are being put up. So now we are talking about the Basel III norms here, which means that definitely you will have version 1 and 2, right? You had something called as Basel 1 and Basel 2 accord as well. So Basel 1 was basically to prevent the international banks from building business volume without adequate capital backing. And Basel 2 was basically based on three pillars of concept, like minimum capital requirements, supervisory review, and also the market risk, that is the market discipline. The same thing, Basel 3 is also the same thing. It is based on the same perspective only, but then with a few changes. So this particular class focuses only on what are the rules or regulations or norms with regard to the Basel 3 perspective, which the central bank of every country has to follow. Okay. So that automatically the commercial banks of that particular country is, they'll be able to function properly. So now talking about the so-called, Basel Accord or Basel norm is, basically they want to ensure that every financial institution of a country, they have sufficient capital. So they're able to meet all their responsibilities or duties and absorb all the unexpected loss or risk that happens. And even for a country, India, come on, we do have an accepted Basel Accord for the banking system. Like Basel Accord 1, 2 and 3. So currently the third perspective and the revised perspective we are discussing. So now if these Basel norms, if they are some set of banking standards, then the next question is, who has the authority to make them? Is it the government or it is some other authority? The question will pop up in your brain. We'll have answers for that. Do not worry. And now, are they mandatory for every country? Like India, you think every other country should go for this? Let's have a look into this particular question. Now, what are norms? The Basel committee of all the banks of the central banks of every country, they form a committee, and that is how the Basel norms are put up. So now the decisions taken by this Basel committee, though they are for the context of financial stability of the banks across the globe also, they have no legal force. Rather, what this Basel committee they do is, of these central banks, okay, all they come together to form the committee, right? They will start supervising the standard, put forward principles, guidelines, and also recommend some statements of best practice. So that every individual country will start adopting it and ensure that their banking activities are carried in a full-fledged manner. So for our country, India, we can either accept or we can reject such kind of norms or regulations depending on the kind of financial system that we want. So if you see, So far, we have implemented, or let's say we have wished to implement all the Basel norms, I can say, because we need to have a proper stability with regard to what the functioning of the banking system, where the central bank is the apex body, that is RBI for our country, India, and the other commercial banks comes under that. Now, to talk about the Basel III, if you see, in the year 2010, take care, basically this is put up, the guidelines were put up, and it was focusing primarily on what, you know, the risk of a run on the bank by requiring different levels of reserve for different forms of bank deposits and other borrowing. In simple terms, I can tell you that in the year 2008, there were a lot of financial crisis. Take care. So basically, the Basel III norms was introduced as a response to that. It was very important, or let's say there was an urgent need wherein you felt that you have to strengthen the banking system as a whole, because many, many developed economies as a whole, because of the global financial crisis, they were undercapitalized, they were overleveraged, and they had a great, great reliance on the short-term funding. So just think about the developing economy like India. The situation was even more pathetic. So it is very important that we have some few guidelines based on which the banks can function properly. Clear? During this crisis, what happened was, like, too much of short-term funding was there. And banks generally rely on this short-term funding because it is profitable. But that was making the banks prone to a lot of risk as such. Now, in the context of this Basel III norms, I can tell you that the aim is very simple. Make sure that all the book activities of the bank, they are capital intensive, and they want to create a very resilient bank system by focusing on four parameters: capital, leverage, funding, liquidity. These four parameters should be satisfied for every bank to function properly. That's what the Basel III norms guidelines is all about. Now, though that is the case, also, do you think, as far as a country India is concerned, was it that easy for us to implement Basel III norms? See, in the year 2019, the RBI had a plan of implementing these norms, but then we literally postponed a bit even towards the end of 2019. I can tell you, we have to do it way back, but then still, if you see, due to several reasons, the RBI kept on postponing the implementation of these norms to 2019. And there are a few reasons for that, because we were faced with a lot of challenges regarding the successful implementation of Basel III norms. One is higher capital requirement for bank. We have public banks, private banks. Now, private banks means they have the autonomy to raise capital. What about public sector banks? Come on, they have to depend on government. Now, in that particular context, basically the capital requirement, it becomes a question mark. Sometimes they'll be able to satisfy the need, sometimes they'll not be able to do due to a lot of expenditure of the government, right? So that was one, challenge. Next important thing was more technology deployment. Now, implementing such kind of Basel norms, now you require a little of sophisticated technology and management, which we are just getting adapted to. Because Indian banks, presently, we do not have such kind of high-fi sophisticated technology, I can tell you. So we have to keep upgrading it. It will incur huge cost on the bank. So automatically, their profitability gets, hurted. Don't you think so? That was another reason. The next important challenge, why the implementation was not that successful, or let's say why it took a long time with regard to a country, India, is liquidity crunch. Because banks, now, they would need to invest more on liquid assets. So only then they'll get some sort of returns, I can tell you, which will again be profitable. But then when there is a higher deployment of funds in the liquid or let's say the assets which can easily be converted to money, it will lead to something called as crowding out of the private sector investment. Automatically, economic growth get affected because there is not much of money supply. The liquidity crunch is happening. So these are the basic challenges. But then if you see, there should be some way forward also. Don't you think so? Yes, there should be. So here we go. The way ahead for the banks. To address all the issues or challenges what we discussed and to protect the profitability margins of the bank, it's very important for the banks to look beyond what the regulatory compliance and take protective actions. Point number one is change in business mix. They need to lend more to profitable yet safe sectors. Let's say, for example, lending to corporate loans is kind of profitable and also safe. They will get a return. Whereas, let's say the priority sectors like agriculture and all, they have to lend because that is indeed important. But then the return or let's say the chances of you recovering the loan could be a little skeptical. But doesn't mean that you have to leave it as such. But for the profitability of bank, then you have to really make a point of lending it more to profitable sector. That is what the way forward and the change in business mix is telling. Take care. But then that doesn't mean that this corporate loans now, whoever has taken a loan under this category, they are so good enough. If you see Vijay Malla, if you see Nirav Modi, what are they doing? The problem of NPA, non-performing assets, or bad loan, that is on the rise because of these corporates. So, but then majority, if you see, yeah, more or less, it is a little safer to, lend to these sectors. Next, low cost funding. That is something which talks about, the banks having a need to focus on having a better business correspondence facilitators. So through that, you'll be able to reach the customers and you'll be able to have a better branch increase, having an impact on the profit margin. And the RBI, the central bank of our country, now in this perspective, we are also thinking of introducing UID-based mobile wallets. So through which we'll be able to increase what the reach of the so-called financial system. So there are many opportunities in this as well. So you can even take this as a way forward. Next is improvement in system and procedure. That is indeed very important, because when you're starting to refine the system and procedure, automatically it will help what guys, the banks, to economize all their risk-weighted asset. Automatically it will help them reducing whatever capital requirements they have to some extent, and they can manage properly. So now, though they would impose a cost in short run also, still they will be getting better returns, I can tell, in future. So now the returns is short, is assured for them. So that is what is more important, right? So these are the way forward, or let's say the suggestions that you can take forward to overcome the issues or challenges with regard to what implementation of Basel III norms for our country, India. So that's all you have to study regarding this Basel III norms in detail. I hope it is crystal clear for you people. So don't forget to like, share and put your valuable feedbacks in the comment box of this video. Any doubts, queries regarding Basel III norms, feel free to get in touch with me via Telegram and also on Academy. So thank you so much, my young officers. See you tomorrow with another trending economy topic of the day. And also make sure that you are able to solve the prelims questions based on these topics, what I'm doing. Okay, so thank you and Jai Hind.